I think the one of the key reason is that still the system works in a way where people are not citizens. People are still subjects, and subjects who have to be controlled and have to be kept sort of subjugated in that way. So citizens' rights and powers are not there yet. I don't think we have yet empowered any of our citizens to that level. We have empowered enough to give them an option to vote and support somebody, but we have not empowered anybody to even question and assert in any way. So I think that is where that continuation of a lot of oppressive systems that we have. And I won't consider it as a, somebody was asking me like, how to rectify these broken parts. I think we have to do some rectification in this broken part. At times I wonder whether whether it is a broken, the part is broken of a functioning system, or the it is a functioning part of a broken system. So maybe the system is intended to be this way, that that people have to be controlled, people have to be shown their place, and they have freedom subject to the individual preferences, individual or the system, whatever that the system seems it can give at a particular period. So that is a continuation from the British colonial era, because most of our administration is control oriented, law and order, not service oriented, but control oriented, law and order oriented. So everybody is somebody who needs to be controlled or made to fall in a line. And none of we have never made any kind of checks at any level. If you see, especially in policing, it's a highly single one hierarchy, and that hierarchy is not nowhere ending nearby. So the hierarchy does not end at a what do you call it, a district level or at a panchayat level. No, the hierarchy ends in the state. It straight away goes up to the state, and further it goes up to the because we have a central union service like an IPS, so it even goes up to the center, even though the law and order as such is a state subject. So we have a hierarchical system where the arm is too long, and there are no intermediate checks at any level. There are no civic society checks, be it at the station level. There are no even legislative checks. There are no legislative committees to oversee. Like you see a congressional hearings happening in the US, where they call the officers and they are questioned continuously. Whereas we don't have. So one of the suggestions I was putting forward to, especially in Tamil Nadu, was that they should see for a system, at least a legislative system, where the opposition MLA could preferably chair the committee, a standing committee on police brutality or police control, and then that could be at one level, at the legislative level. At the same time, there is also need to be systemic checks at a police station level, which is a functional unit. So at the police station level, there is absolutely nothing. They would only listen to the SP and further along that line, and nothing else matters. So if SP has given a go ahead, there is nothing that the SHO or the CO or DSP, whomever, the way you call it. So for him, it's a free hand afterwards. So there needs to be an external check at the station level also. I'm not saying, bring civilian administration again and then put a control. I don't think it works that way. It has to be a democratic check, and that democratic check has to come from people who are in various representing various sections of the society to be there at the police station as a check on various things, and something of that sort needs to be worked out. Otherwise, I think we are going continuously in this kind of, if unless somebody dies, things are okay for us. Until 2 person died, I was quite. If you look at my Twitter thing, of course, I'm taking a break, slightly long break. But if you look at that point of time when the migrants were going back to their home, they were not protesting, they were not objecting to anything from the state. The state or the government did not give any food, the government did not give any kind of facilities. Government even stopped the trains and other conveyance buses so that they could go, they will not be able to go back home. So not only did the state fail to serve, state actually actively stopped any kind of helping activity that could happen. So they did not protest. Just imagine that none of those people, they protested asking for food, or they did not protest for asking for any facility. Instead, they simply took their kids and their luggages and started walking. That is the level of submissiveness that we have in our citizenry. They did not ask the government any question. They did not protest, nothing. They said, okay, no bus, no train. We won't get food here. We won't get water here. We don't have any other option. We have to walk. Let's all walk. Thousands of kilometers. Let's walk. So walking is a viable option, more feasible option to them rather than asking questions to the government. And even after that, forget about all this, wherever they were trying to cross a border, they were beaten up by the police, by Madhya Pradesh police, by Uttar Pradesh police. At every level they were crossing, they were beaten up. Even then, just for wanting to go back home, they just wanted to go back home. Nothing else. We created temporary jails out of stadium. There was a circular from Haryana, DGP, if I'm not wrong, saying that people who are doing jaywalking, just going back home, if they don't listen to you, you should put them in jails. And the jails will be temporary stadium. Stadiums may be converted into temporary jails, and they may be lodged in jail because they wanted to go back, because they're not having food and water. They wanted to go back home. They want to be, when the pandemic is there, they want to. And they were beaten up, and we were okay. We were okay when they were getting beaten up. Many of us were even saying that, bewakoof hai kyun bahar nikal rahe, ghar pe baithna chahiye. Whatever be the case, how can police beat people up? And this is not, I'm right now saying, I had these concerns while I was in the system also. But of course, you can't directly intervene in the policing when you are in the IAS side. You have an indirect control of law and order. So you can minimize the use of force as a district magistrate. But the random usage of force has come to be a common thing. It's no more a surprising thing. We are beating our own people. How can somebody use a lathi against, let's say three people are standing at a corner, two police person would come, are ghar ja, if they're not going, they'll just beat them up with a lathi. And we are okay. But the people would say, mariye mat sir, are kyun maar rahe ho sir, kyun hai, kya, why, please, no. We don't say, who are you? How can you beat me? We don't ask this question. Ki, wo kaise maar kaise sakte? Main yahan pe khada hoon. Mujhe ghar jaane ke liye bol rahe. Theek hai, alag baat hai. Agar koi rule hai, toh chala jaunga. But maar kaise sakte? Marna is an assault. It's a physical violence. And if it was anybody else jo wo karte hote, so then that would have actually meant, it would have meant assault. But using a lathi against anybody randomly, for Indian in the system, it is not even considered as an assault. It is just natural. उसको दो लाठी मार के आ जाए बस खत्म बात खत्म है एंड बोलते भी है वी टेल आल्सो मे बी इट्स अ ब्रिटिश थिंग इट कुड आल्सो बी द कास्ट ऑपरेशन व्हिच हैज बीन गोइंग ऑन बिकॉज़ द सबमिसिवनेस एट सम लेवल इज अनएक्सप्लेनेबल यू कांट एक्सप्लेन हाउ कैन पीपल हैव नो एक्सपेक्टेशन फर्स्ट एंड देन फॉरगेट अबाउट नो एक्सपेक्टेशन इवन द स्टेट और द गवर्नमेंट इज एक्टिवली ट्राइंग टू destroy whatever little thing that they have made for themselves. Even then, there is nothing. So the level of acceptance or submission to authority, submission to power, as if there is no agency, that is quite surprising. And at that point of itself, I was writing that police reforms is something that needs to be worked out very seriously. If as a citizenry, we have to work, because wherever we are raising an issue of freedom of expression or asserting a rights, the first stumbling block is police oppression or police brutality that coming in. And we have done a number of encounters and nobody questions. Hyderabad, we did, the police did to the people who were purportedly, had raped, allegedly rapists. And they were shot dead, and every country was celebrating. I remember having a session in Bihar at that point of time with a school, and I was asking this question, whether it is correct. And everybody said, yes, it is correct, it was required. If it happens to your sister, will you not do? And that should have been done. So that is the kind of argument that comes in. But without asserting the fact that first I have to ascertain that it is the person who, who's committed the crime, who's committed it. And he has also been given an option because nobody else was there. It is not a matter of something happening on the spot and police using force to stop the crime. It was not the case. Police was actively trying to do something else after the crime has happened. So that, and these discussions also, I don't think we have sufficiently. But underlying point is this, that citizen is a key concept in a republic. Citizen is a key concept in a democracy. And citizen has rights. And those rights include you know, not to be physically violated, especially for, by the state, unless and until under the law. There has to be a law which will, that is the whole point of having a constitution, having laws, etc. It is as a check towards excesses from the state. And that is individual, that is a citizen. So if you give away that power, and we have been, it's not just this government, or I'm not talking about historically that has been the case. At some point, I think we need to reassert our of being a citizen, of being a citizen with rights in the country. I think that that may be a very long answer I gave, but that's pretty much what I had in mind when I was thinking of all this. Your crux of the question is whether the policing or the police, Indian police system as such, has a caste bias, or you know, or majoritarian tendency. I think it, to put it that way, or majoritarian and caste bias. I would rather put it in this way that even though it is supposed to, most of the institutions simply reflect the power structures in the society. So. Policing, so how does it, very simple example of today, that Vikas Dubey, the guy who killed around 8 policemen in Uttar Pradesh, right? If it was, if the person was from some other caste, or if the person was from a minority, I don't think he would have been out fully. He would have been in jail. There are some 60 cases against him, that's what is reported. So he wouldn't have been out for to have this encounter and kill policemen today. But he would have been very clearly in jail. Even if for half a case, the person would have been in jail for a long time. But it also reflects that thing. What happens is like an institution with power. So the policing has unbridled power. So when that happens, wherever there is a resistance, it checks. It becomes a check. Where there is no resistance coming from the society, it, you know, it just continues that perpetration. Whether it is because the policing itself is a casteist institution, or whether it is just reflecting the realities and, you know, hence continuing that way, that is something needs to be seen, because it accentuates in somewhere. It accentuates. I think I know there is one of my senior colleague in Chhattisgarh, if I'm not wrong, had written something about the number of Dalits and Adivasis who are in jail, the disproportionate number of Dalits and Adivasis and Muslims who are in jail, because of the lack of judicial access and the legal access and all those things. And immediately there was a lot of uproar against that, and he was transferred, and a lot of things had happened just for you know, stating these facts. So, yeah. I don't know. I don't think the institution per se is that. But if you look at it, Indian bureaucracy, Indian any top bureaucracy, there is always a particular, there was a study in EPW, if I'm not wrong, 66% of the top bureaucracy is always from a higher caste. It is, irrespective of whichever the proportion comes. When it comes to secretaries at the government of India, it is at even a higher level. Now, when that happens, you know, it is being normally told as some sort of a merit or meritocratic kind of a thing. But what happens is the lens of looking at things change, because their lived reality is different from a lived reality of a Dalit, or a lived reality of an Adivasi, or a lived reality of a minority, of a Muslim. So their view, the lens with which, the perspective with which they look at governance issues changes, because it is from their lens that they're looking, and everything else becomes sort of, you know, issues to be not important enough issues, because these are not issues that they faced. But this is, whether it is intentional, whether it is systemic, I don't know. I have not formed an opinion, such a firm opinion on that, to be honest. But what can be, like what I see right now is that it reflects, and since the opposition to it is very weak from the society, it continues that oppression with wherever the oppression can happen. And to be you know, honest, in India, the caste is one sort of oppression which can happen continuously. That kind of assertion has not still happened with a lot of communities. So it just continues like that. It becomes an arm of oppression. It becomes a tool of control and whoever is wielding the power uses that tool to further control. So if the power is with you know, the upper caste or the upper class, upper caste kind of people, then of course the tool would also be wielded according to their wishes. But I would rather, you know, I still would like to frame the question, like frame my this thing as, it's not a question of either one assertion or the another assertion, or one caste assertion or a community assertion or a minority assertion. No, I would see it as a citizen issue, because nobody is a citizen. A lot of people who get beaten up for no reason are also not citizens. I'm not saying to justify it, something else, but on overall, if you're part of the system, you're powerful. If you're not part of the system, you're not powerful. And if you're not powerful, you don't have any rights. Your rights are actually at the mercy of the government or whoever is powerful. So that is a situation that I feel. But of course, it comes from my own lived reality, so that my perspectives could also be biased by that. Again, geographically, it will look at various areas. Like I was in Northeast, so there is a very different kind of situation there. I'm from Kerala. There, a different kind of situation is there. Tamil Nadu has a very different kind of situation. So it is not uniformly correct to say X is the truth. That's what I felt. It is very different. In different geographical areas, there are different kind of assertions which happens. Even there is a dominant caste scenario also at many places, where it is not the caste in place of in the hierarchy which is the topmost caste, but the dominant caste which is more powerful economically, numerically, etc., becomes takes that part. But on an overall, yes, definitely there is no doubt about this, that the question of my own case, I can say I was collected in Dadra Nagar Haveli, where almost 50% of the population are tribal population. And many of them who used to come earlier, they never used to come to the offices only many a times, but slowly they started coming. And when they start to come, they won't sit down. And if they are sitting outside, if they are coming outside and they are waiting, they would sit on the floor. They will not sit on the chair. They would sit on the floor. And that was quite surprising, because it is their country. I am getting paid by whatever tax they are paying, be it purchasing a top or anything. And the office is there to serve them. And they don't feel entitled to even sit there. So, of course, 100% the question of citizenship, whether they feel equally about the assertion part of the citizenship is there or not. But I have also seen at the same place a migrant from Bihar or, you know, coming there. He also has a similar kind of subservient attitude to many issues, where he, because he doesn't feel belonging there, and he comes there and he also looks, sir, you know, at a very... It is not an assertive kind of a thing, that we need these XYZ services are there where you're getting paid for, and we need those services. We are not here to be, you know, controlled and issued. So that is where I said it might be, while it is the truth, it is definitely true that Dalits, Adivasi, Muslims, the citizenship or the powers or the empowerment, or what you call the citizenry kind of powers, are very much lacking. It is also true that there are many other sections also, when they are displaced from their own locality, where they are migrants. A lot of people whom you call Bengalis, Biharis, who go outside and work somewhere else, they also face a similar kind of issues. So this is an overall reality. I would simply say that, again, whether you have access to the power, whether you have access to the system there, whether you have access to anything of governmental authoritarian structure there, it makes you a citizen or not. If you have somebody to call and say, "Ki sir, ye mere saath galat ho raha hai," then suddenly you become a citizen. If you don't have anybody to give a call and say, then you are not a citizen. So this kind of a... So our citizenry is subject to access to power. So if you have access to power, you are a citizen. If you don't have access to power, you are not a citizen. And that is true for everybody. But I agree to your question to that. In a large, if you look at it in a macro perspective, yes, the assertion that has to come, the citizen assertion that has to come from Dalits, or Adivasis and minorities especially, has a long way to go in India. I see a very interesting point, because our identities are very fluid, in the sense, you might, you know, the identity of a gender is prominent when you are not part of the system. When you're part of the system, it's not the gender that becomes a prominent identity. It is the system that becomes your prominent identity. So you become part of it. You are no more a woman in the police. You are a police who is a woman. So that becomes the key aspect. And that happens across. That happens, be it through reservation, be it through... Very few retain the original identity. Most of them, because it itself is a barrier to cross, you know, that I want to be police is because I want to become that identity. You know, I want to be part of that identity. And that becomes your primary identity. And it then becomes almost all of your actions, your behavior gets defined by that newly acquired identity rather than your primary identity that you had from before. And this is why many officers, female officers I know, who would have never said any gali, would have never said anything bad after coming into police, after certain times, you know, just to assert there that I'm equally capable of policing, they have to beat people up and they have to say all these bad words, just to say. And they've shared this also, that we have to say it. Unless we say it and, you know, the rest of the policemen won't respect you, the rest of the policemen won't say that, you know, she is fit to be. And it then becomes, how do you suit yourself to become part of the system? How you can be the most prominent member of the system? You know, how can you be the best of that, whatever is the worst of the system? So that is, I think, diversity is important, is very important. All people should be there. And it should be in every walk of life, be it media, be it bureaucracy, be it policing, be it judiciary. In all walks of life, there should be sufficient representation to all sections. It is not for access, you know, one key aspect is, it slightly changes the lens, the perspective. Even though the identity takes over, it somewhere puts a small perspective or a lens which is there, you know, because some of those things become acceptable to them also, unacceptable to them also. But more than diversity, I think checks have to be there. Checks in the sense, democratic checks have to be there. And democratic checks shouldn't be such a long circle. You know, the policing shouldn't go up to the DGP and then the Home Secretary and then the Home Minister, and then that will come circle the whole. That shouldn't be the thing. If I have an issue, I should be at least able to talk to my MLA at least, and so that he can move a motion, you know, put a thing in this in the legislative, in the committee for this thing, and then at least let that be discussed there. There should be some access. The police also should know there are other access to control. It's not the single hierarchy that goes. And multiple checks, even though many people would say that is not a good way because it hampers a lot of things, but our policing is not to attack and kill people. Our policing is to, maintain peace and security, and also to prevent or investigate crime. So these two aspects, law and order and the crime investigation aspect. So it doesn't require that kind of an army kind of a thing, that, you know, unity of command and chain of command, and you do and you go and kill people. That kind of a thing. Whereas policing is slowly turning that way. That is more dangerous. Policing from a people-oriented, service-oriented activity to a control-oriented and even, like that chain of command oriented kind of a structure it is becoming. I think that is dangerous, because that will only escalate the kind of violence. When the police starts having high equipment guns, which you've seen in US, the criminals also start having such kind of equipment. And this becomes the kind of a loop which we go into. Whereas many countries in Europe, you would see it's a very mildly violent, you know, they are not violent police force. They are more service oriented, and that's a sort of a relationship that has to be worked for a long term. So I would, diversity representation is good, very good, required, but that won't be the solution as per se. That will be one part of it. The democratic checks also won't be the solution, but it will be another part of it. At least I would have some access to somebody in my locality whom I know. And it shouldn't be a majoritarian check. It should be again a representative check at that level, so that I have somebody whom I can talk to and say that there is an issue and for which I'm being harassed. Otherwise, the many cases which are coming up, I'm also aware of so many cases, even during my own tenure, wherever there used to be even a slight protest which used to happen, we used to be told first, ki uske khilaf file banao. फाइल बनाओ मतलब फाइंड समथिंग अगेंस्ट हिम एंड
हाँ
सो बीइंग द डीएम एंड सो को यूज्ड टू बी पार्ट ऑफ मोस्ट ऑफ द मीटिंग्स एंड यूज्ड टू बी टोल्ड यू नो अलोंग विद एसपी दैट उसके खिलाफ फाइल बनाओ, फाइल बना के उसको सबक सिखा दो उसको समवेयर योर सो वी डोंट सी देम एज अ सिटीजन हु इज असर्टिंग, ही इज नॉट डूइंग एनी क्राइम, ही इज जस्ट असर्टिंग हिज राइट्स एंड एक्सप्रेसिंग हिज ओपिनियन, बट वी आर यूजिंग द एंटायर स्टेट मशीनरी टू सप्रेस दैट, टू सप्रेस दैट and to just shut him down forever so that sabak sikhana. And the Indian policing also relies a lot on sabak sikhana in the sense to make an example out that ek ko example bana do taki nobody else will do it and this becomes a humne bol diya nahi suna kar do char logon ke samne kar do 10 log aur dekhe 10 people more should see it so that it becomes an example but at the same time a lot of the police force also needs to be seen from an empathetic view you would see them all many of them are also not very comfortable with the kind of structure they are in which an oppressive structure is invariably an oppressive structure within also it's not that it is just outside it becomes oppressive within that system itself it becomes highly oppressive because it is a bol diya to karna hai galat hai sahi hai none of that matters and every person with a slight amount of conscience also make you know finds it very difficult and then they you know slowly either become part of the system as you say or at some point they break down so this happens to a lot of policemen this is also an issue which needs to be addressed so this will actually help if more and more one of the key thing that has happened in US in one of the studies is where there are more NGOs where there are more non-governmental organizations, voluntary organizations, civil society organizations, there two things have happened. One, the crimes have gone down. Two, the police brutality and the police, the adversary kind of a thing with the policing has gone down. I worked in Mizoram. Mizoram, the police plays a very minimal role in most of the things. There are very good NGOs which work as a sort of, you know, tempering kind of a thing. So when there is a meeting, you call all the NGOs, you call the you know, you call the police, you call the NGOs, you call everybody, and say that this is an issue. We need to solve it out. Solve it. And most often, it's the NGOs who come forward and try to solve it. You know, and have a discussion with them. And because it is in a happening, most of the resolutions happen in an amicable way. It's not a kind of an oppressive way. And this has been studied and proven in one of the studies in US also. The more organizations are there, the more civil society organizations are there, the more engagement happens across from the system to the common man. The crimes also drop down and the adversarial positions between police and the common citizen also changes because it becomes much more easier. You know, we are all trying together to do something. It's not that the police's aim and the people's aim are two different things. No. Police is an arm which the people have actually made so that it is there to further the people's aim. It is just a tool, you know, a way that we have found out, an efficient way that we think is to keep the peace and security of the area. Now, if the engagement that doesn't happen between the people and that area in that locality, then it becomes difficult because then it becomes an adversary position. Whereas it can be a more civic position, more you know, friendly position between the citizens and the police. And I think there a lot more voluntary organizations, a lot more of this representative civic society organizations needs to be encouraged. And so that people also have an access when they have a grievance to various people who are in power. And also, I think legislature cannot, you know, delegate or relegate this accountability and supervisory things to commissions. So I'm not a big fan of NHRC, the Human Rights Commission or state human rights commissions, because these are ultimately appointed position where there is one person and then, you know, they will take one case or two case from a state where there are thousands of cases, 500 cases in every state which are coming. And that is also highly arbitrary, which are the cases that they pick. And it just happens. And then because they're also part of the system, you all try to you know, talk to them nicely and call them sir five times, and then they also say okay, jao, know, nothing happens. At the same time, but if there is something in the legislature, because if there is an opposition MLA-led committee, let's assume in Tamil Nadu, if they could have at least looked into the case and taken a position which is different from the government, and that would have actually put a lot of pressure on the police also, that next time if I do something, it's not just the government that I have to answer to, but also a democratic committee is there, where there are, we generally don't value our MLAs. We think more politicians are getting more power, but as a check against an unbridled power in one center, you need to have another, a more distributed kind of a power center when it comes to the police. I think that needs to be addressed, and more organizational engagement, civic society engagement across the line also needs to be done. I think that's what I think.
Okay.